Yes, guys. Welcome back to another podcast. We're finally back. The TG podcast has returned. And yes, the World Cup is on. But look, we have to bring it back because Arsenal are coming back very, very soon. And of course, with me as always is my man, Seb. Welcome back to the podcast, brother. How you been coping through this World Cup?
Yeah, I've been missing the Arsenal, of course. But at the same time, I am enjoying this World Cup. There's some good games. England are going well into the quarterfinals. And yeah, there's some really tasty quarterfinals coming along now. So it's definitely all worth looking forward to. But of course, we miss the mighty Arsenal.
Of course, the Arsenal do return back on Boxing Day against West Ham. And yeah, we all know how good we were before the World Cup started, you know. And look, Seb has kindly let me, borrow his article that he does, that he writes. I'm going to read through that. I've shortened it down a little bit, just so it'll be a bit more quicker, but we're going to read through that because, it's a very crazy stat that Arsenal have one of the best starts in Premier League history. So we're going to read that right now. And yeah, make sure, guys, if you've not followed Seb, follow him on Instagram, Twitter and all that stuff because, he doesn't have a YouTube channel, but he does on other social media. And of course, he's a guy who always comes on this channel for the podcast as well. And we are expecting a few more other guests as well to turn up soon, but I don't know where they are at the moment, but let's just wait and see. Anyway, without further ado, let's get right into it. So, yeah. As I said, guys, we all know Arsenal, yeah, what a start to the Premier League season. And we'll read through what Seb was his article today. So, yeah, Arsenal sit 5 points clear at the top of the Premier League after producing the best ever start to a season. The team has accumulated 37 points from 14 games and have just dropped 5 points in the league. They have never managed a better return in history. Arsenal only lost to Man United and a draw to Southampton. Newcastle are the only team that share the record for their fewest defeats, and both clubs have the best defensive record with 11 goals conceded. Arsenal have the most clean sheets, 7 and 12 wins, which are the most in this season so far. One of the best starts of Premier League history. However, there still remains doubt that Arsenal can push Man City due to the squad depth and a tough fixture list. The club must strengthen in January, and then there's a bit of some stats of how well we're doing this season. So the most goals scored, Martin Odegaard, most assists was Bukayo Saka, passes Saliba, tackles Ben White, fouls Jesus, and then of course play 14 games, 33 goals, only 11 conceded, 7 clean sheets, only 1 loss, 1 draw, 12 wins, and 100% home record. And look, I read through that, right, and I was like, what a start to this season. And look, Seb, mate, of course, this was your own article. And look, so what's your thoughts about this season, of course, so far?
Oh, it's been brilliant. Well, you can't complain because we've been winning all our games apart from a couple. We never thought we'd start this well, especially after the way that we ended our season. But yeah, it's been absolutely brilliant to watch. And we have played some of the best football in the league. And no matter what anyone says, we are the best team in the league so far this season. And we have been. And we've deserved all our wins. It's not like we've been poor and been grinding them all out. Bar a couple we have. But still, even so, that's what champions do. They still find a way to get results, even when they're not playing well. We saw that's what we have been doing. We saw it against Leeds. We saw it against Fulham earlier this season. And people can come up with saying, oh, but Arsenal haven't played anyone good yet. We beat Spurs in the North London Derby 3-1. We beat Liverpool 3-2. We went to Stamford Bridge and absolutely dominated Chelsea. So listen, you've just got to do what you've got to do. And so far, that's what the team has been doing. Every player in the first team has done their jobs well. And yeah, we deserve to be. But the question is whether we can keep this going. And now it's a big question now. I'm sure we'll come on to that later in the podcast.
Yes. And look who we've got with us, guys. Another Arsenal fan, Brandon from The Goal Difference. Thanks so much, bro, for taking your time out to come on the channel. Can you hear us all good? Everything all good?
Yeah. I can hear you guys all good. Sorry, I was a bit late because the extra times, right? I just ended my stream. Yeah, it was an all-time high for my stream. Yeah, it was really good. It was really good. Unfortunately, see Japan. Yeah, unfortunate. But yeah. I think after those penalties, I think they deserve to get out anyway. It was terrible penalties from Japan.
Yeah, man. Brandon, thanks so much for coming on. And what's the time in Singapore right now? I'm presuming it's really late.
2 a.m. It's 2 a.m.
2 a.m. Crazy.
Yeah, I'm doing the live stream later for Brazil and Korea. So I need...
That's a dedication, yeah. Brother. But no, you haven't missed that much. We've been live for about 5 minutes. And basically, what I just read through, like Seb done an article, and yeah, this has been one of the best... this has been the best start for Arsenal in Premier League history. Seb, is this better than the Invincibles as well, in terms of like...
The start,
because yes. I know that we drew quite a lot of games with the Invincibles.
We drew quite a few games that have a start.
It's crazy. And I was just saying, like, look, your thoughts, of course, Brandon, on the start of this season for Arsenal.
I mean... As Arsenal, you guys have been supporting Arsenal. We have been Arsenal fans for so long, all our lives, right? And then to see such great start, it's like what Sebastian said, is the best start that we ever had, even better than Invincibles, right? So, yeah. You know, we cannot get too carried away, especially this unprecedented year with the World Cup, right? But, I mean, looking at the players so far, Gabriel Jesus, we'll probably talk about him later as well, right? The upcoming updates and whatnot. But yeah, I'm super happy with Arsenal's. You know, this is just a small point here. I think this goes to show that our faith, I would imagine you guys, our faith in Arteta has paid off, you know. There's one point that was a bit rocky with Arteta, and then, you know, there were a lot of fans, a very diverse fan base here to like, oh, we need to sack him, we need to keep him. I was always been loyal because, you know, as Arsenal fans, I think we've been bred to be a bit more patient. I believe that it was the right decision to hold Arteta, and fantastic. You know, I'm really happy with Arsenal's start of the season.
Yeah, fair enough, man. Look, I was actually one of the fans who sort of did change a little bit towards when we got to, not the end of last season. It was when we played against, you know, Villarreal that season and we finished eighth. I was like, eighth is not good enough for a cup of Arsenal Football Club, you know. And end of the day, right, this manager is really proving me wrong. And look, as I said this other times, right, If he gets me this season, which we already are in, a title challenge, right, by the end of this season, and we've got to keep it to that because we can't go and bottle it and finish fifth again this season, off the start we've had, then I'll openly, right, hold up my hands and I'll say, Arteta, I'm sorry I got it wrong, right, and look, fair play to him, right? But look, many Arsenal fans who are Arteta out, they won't do that for me because I ain't gonna mention any names, but they just, you know, they just have like this agenda towards Arteta. But at the end of the day, right, I will hold my hands up and I will say, look, I got it wrong, and big up Arteta, and yeah, fair play to him. But look, we're going to move on now, of course. So the next topic is very unfortunate and very frustrating because, as you can see, Gabriel Jesus is injured. Now, I had a funny feeling that something like this will happen when we're playing the World Cup. Of course, I had a funny feeling that some of our players will get injured because it's a World Cup, and that's understandable. But Jesus is out, and apparently, correct me if I'm wrong, right, it is 3 months, if I'm not wrong.
Well, it's not definitely confirmed, but nothing's definitely confirmed, but that's just all the reports that he might have to have surgery, but we haven't heard anything from the club yet. It's still just speculation, but there is a strong possibility that he will need for surgery.
Because in the day, right?
We don't know until the club fully...
Yeah, because it's not official yet. It's not actually official.
No, it's not official. It's just
there's been many rumours and leaks going around that it's 3 months. Like, he got injured, I think, after Cameroon or something. And apparently he's out for the whole of the World Cup. So if he's out for the whole of the World Cup, it must be serious, you know. Do you know what he's done? Is it his knee? Is it
knee injury? He felt discomfort in his knee. Sadly, a knee injury is very serious.
Very serious, yeah. Knee injury,
where you run, that's where you...
Right, you do everything with your knee. Like when you turn, when you run, you know. Like, it protects all the muscles as well. Like, crazy, man. So look... let's just say that it is going to be, well, fingers crossed it's not that long, right? But let's just say he's going to miss Boxing Day against West Ham, miss a game against Brighton, miss a game against, who else we got?
Newcastle,
right?
Yeah.
This is, for me, a very big blow, of course, to Arsenal, because although he hasn't scored, I know he's been on a scoring drought. When he plays for Arsenal, right, he brings us that something different. So then, like someone like Eddie Nketiah, because this is who got to play now as he's injured, Eddie Nketiah. And for me, I'm not confident with Eddie Nketiah. Like, he could prove us all wrong, and he'd be like, yeah, you know what, I'm going to go. Well, this is his chance now, isn't it? To prove people wrong. He's got his chance now to step in and to see how he to get a few goals or whatever. But I'm not confident with him. Like, starting off with you, Seb, right? obviously your thoughts on this injury and your thoughts on Eddie Nketiah having to play instead of Jesus.
Well, listen, I hate to sound to be absolutely negative, and especially after this, but I think this is a serious blow because, like you said, even when Jesus doesn't score goals, his all-round play, the energy he brings and things to the team, just elevates the team, and it has made a big difference this season. And you know what? When I go back through these years when we've not won the title, when we've challenged for some of the season, I look at this. In 2008, we were 5 points clear at the start of February. Edrardo broke his leg against Birmingham, out for the rest of the season. We ended up finishing third. 2014, we were going well on Boxing Day. Aaron Ramsey in particular was absolutely firing and killing it. Aaron Ramsey injures his leg, out for 3 months, finished fourth. And then 2016, a year Leicester won it. Cazorla in October injures himself in the North London Derby, out for the rest of the season. We end up 10 points behind Leicester. And these are the things that are really worrying when you get a long-term injury like that. It does affect morale, and I'm sure it happens with every team, especially a key player like Jesus. And yes, we've got the January window open, and there are options in January that we can actually go for, but it is essential that we do replace it. We do get another striker in, because I just don't think, and Ketia, I know we have to support all our players, but we have seen this guy time and time again, and I'm afraid he's just not good enough. And you can sit there and say this is his chance. So the thing is, he's had plenty of chances, especially towards the end of the last season. Yes, he did score, I think it was five goals towards the end of the season, but he still didn't get us. He still got us from fourth to fifth, so it still wasn't enough. And these things are really a blow. And but someone did actually say this earlier, and he actually makes a good point. An injury to Thomas Partey would have been worse and an injury to Tierney, because when we Partey and Tierney was injured, there was no steel in midfield, there was no cover back.
Because Seb, look at it, you got to play Lokonga instead of Lokonga. For me, is not good enough, bro.
No, not good enough.
Send him out on loan, because a loan will probably be good for him for experience. Yeah, he's just not ready yet for me.
But the thing is that they were saying that would have been worse, because even though Jesus has actually been on a bit of a scoring drought, and still getting goals around the pitch, which has been better. It's not like in previous seasons when we're relying on Aubameyang to score, Sanchez to score, Van Persie to score.
Yeah,
we have actually had that this season. We've had goals around the pitch, like we said. Odegaard is our top goal scorer, so. But they say it's more keeping the goals out that will help us more than scoring us. So that is
a thing.
But if you're going to actually challenge for the title, you need all your best players fit. And Jesus is one of our key players. And I really think he has been the catalyst to taking us to the next level. And I do actually think this is going to be a blow. This is going to be a blow for us. And it can happen to any team, but it was just seriously, it had to be him out of all players. And
Seb, do you not think, right, we should maybe play Gabriel Martinelli as a main striker? Because he played against Chelsea when we drew 2-2 and he scored. At the end of the day, right, he can play there as well. I know he's more of a left winger, but we have not played any game. We can play Martinelli as a main striker. But then people say, oh, who's put on the left wing? Because who's our backup for Martinelli? Is it Smith Rowe? Smith Rowe's back now, isn't he?
Yeah, he is back.
Yeah. So would you do that?
Well, again, saying that, to be honest with you, I would rather that than playing Ketia. I would rather that. But also, a winger is also, we need to buy a winger in the window. I'm sure we'll get onto that later in the podcast. But maybe if we buy another winger, then we could actually try Monet down the middle. And yes, there's also Smith Rowe that can do a job on the left as well. But yeah, our options are really thin in that department. And when you've got the games coming up, because we've got a big January coming up, and if you thought the fixture congestion was bad before the World Cup, it's going to be even worse after the World Cup, especially with Europa League coming in. And this is where you need all your key players. And what worries me is that the first team is great, but the drop off from that is massive, because we saw it against Brighton in the Cup. when the fringe players just didn't perform. And even some of the Europa League stages, like when we played PSV the second time, they didn't perform. Yeah. Even in that Zurich game when we just scraped a 1-0, they didn't perform. And against Bodo Glimt when we were holding on, they didn't perform. Instead, yeah. Okonga, Elneny, and Ketia, they're not good enough.
And another thing said, right, this happens every game, right? You look at that bench, yeah? And for me, I look at that bench and think, that is so weak. Compare that bench to Man City's bench, right? They have 3-4 players can bring off and make an impact. Arsenal, what player can really come off that bench to make an impact? I know you've got like Reece Nelson and all that, but look, at the end of the day, we have not got a proper player like that who can come off the bench and say if we're losing a game, drawing a game, that can change the game, you know? We haven't got that.
And this is why this January is very important that we do strengthen, that we do add in the right players, because I seriously think we now need at least 3 players now if we're going to stay up there, especially if it is true that Jesus does need the surgery and is going to be missing for 3 months, because it's going to be a bigger blow than most people think. We're going to see it in the coming months. So they better identify their targets and bring them in early and hit the ground running. I know the club lately are not keen on panic buying. They want to make sure it's the right player before they get them in, which is fair enough, but they need to seriously think about what they're doing and need to get this right, because this is a big opportunity. We put ourselves in a great position and we need to be going for this and need to be keeping up with it. But this is not the news we wanted to hear. And now this will really test the board and the ambition, whether they're going to back this manager. Yes, we're going to come on to it later in the podcast, but they backed him at the worst of times, but now they need to back him at the best of times.
Yeah, 100%, bro. Coming to you now, Brandon, my friend. What's your whole thoughts on, like, of course, Hayes getting injured and us having to play Eddie Nkeka as the main striker?
Well, Sebastian and you, Josh, you've made really good points. I don't think there's much for me to add, but yeah, I think let's talk about a different. Maybe I come in from a different angle, right? Yeah. So to Sebastian's point, I think if we had to get an injury, right, for one of our first team players, I think Gabriel Jesus would have been the best option, but. The lesser of two evils, I would say. Because imagine we had an injury to Partey, like what you said, Josh. No way we can trust on Lekonga, and no offense to Elneny. Elneny is good, but he's just not that quality Premier League midfielder that we need along with Xhaka. Because I think when Elneny comes on, Xhaka's workload will be intense, and that's when he makes a lot of mistakes, and you know the aggression will show, right, for Granit Xhaka. So I think Partey, now that he's back with Arsenal right now, I think that's fantastic. Gabriel Jesus out, like what you guys say, is going to be a big blow to us. Yes, he's on a goal drought, but you know his impact on the field is really felt by all the players, right? Although he doesn't score, he's on a goal drought, but the kind of link up play he has, the kind of respect that the defenders, you know, he when he's on, the defenders have to really respect him, you know, and that's what we need. It's been a long time since we had a striker like this. You know, you can make an argument Giroud, but Giroud's a different kind of beast all around. Yeah, he's a different kind of beast. I would say. X-factor player, like, it's just like what you said, George, is Martinelli. You know, I was just talking to a friend of mine. When was the last time that we really had an X-factor player like this?
Well, I would say maybe Alexis Sanchez. I said it on your stream. I said it, Sanchez, for me. He was.
So Alexis Sanchez, till now, we didn't have a really kind of an X-factor kind of player. So it's great to see Martinelli, you know, stepping up to the plate. And to your point, do you think that we can see... Okay, let's just say we be prudent, right? Like, Arsenal fans, you know, that I would assume that, yes, the ambition is high. I think that right now, the January transfer window is going to be big for us. It's going to be huge, right? But let's just assume that we being Arsenal fans, I don't know about this, just me, right? Being a bit prudent, you know, being like, okay, you know what? Let's assume that Kroenke and the lads and Edu do not do much business. Do we really see Martinelli as our option up front? Because our wing will be what, Reece Nelson and Smith Rowe, possibly? I don't know. It could be an option. Definitely, of course, the best case scenario is Edu goes to Kroenke and the management and say, okay, look, this is like what Sebastian said. This is our best start that we had in Premier League history, right? We need to get reinforcements right now. We cannot screw this up, right? If we were fifth or we were sixth, we get Gabriel Jesus out, you know, I would imagine, okay, it's going to be another Arsenal typical year. We're not going to spend so much money. We're going to grind it from the back. We're going to build our young core. But this year is exceptionally very different, like what you guys pointed out. I think we really, if we want to show ambition to the club, we want to show ambition to the fans, right? We need to go out and sign someone. Whether is it going to be an overpay? It will definitely be an overpay. Don't get me wrong, right? Any January transfer window signing is going to be an overpay. But who are we going to sign, right? We did mention in another stream, Full Cook, right? I'm a big Full Cook fan. Maybe Full Cook. Possibly. Let me think. I had this thought, a chat with my other friends. I was thinking like Kevin Volen, a player from Monaco, right? Monaco, right? Maybe someone like that, a bit older. Monaco's not doing too well in Ligue 1. Maybe we can sweep in for the kill and get a Kevin Volland. He's not the typical marquee signing that we would dream of, but he could be a perfect replacement for that 2-3 months that we are missing Gabriel Jesus. You know, one of those players, in my opinion. And yeah, big loss for Arsenal. But we still have faith. I still have faith, right? Like, but to Sebastian's point, we don't have enough depth compared to like City, compared to even Chelsea. You can make an argument. Our depth is like non-existent. So yeah, I mean, to sum it all up, I think that we need to sign someone as in terms of ambition. But if we do not sign anyone, you know what? We have to go with the flow and got to trust Nketiah, maybe. We really have to trust Nketiah.
Well, Brandon, that's some great points there from you, my friend. And you bring us nicely onto the next topic, which is the transfer window. Arsenal transfers, of course, in January. And yeah, look, we're not stupid as Arsenal fans. We know we need players and we hope that Edu and Arteta and Kroenke and all them will actually spend this window, because last season, guys, January window, we signed no one and our main focus was getting rid of Aubameyang. Yeah, we got rid of him, but we didn't sign anyone, which ultimately cost us getting top four as well, in my opinion. So look, will it be different this time around? I do think we will sign, because we're in a very good position, and come on, they have to. They've got to do it, man. And look, so we're going to go through, of course, some of the transfers that both you guys and myself would like to see Arsenal sign, of course, and of course some that are probably are realistic. But yeah, so Seb, starting off for you, my friend. Just give your thoughts about this upcoming window and some of the players that you would like to see, some of the positions and, you know, the players that you'd like to see Arsenal sign in this January window.
Yeah, as we said, this is the most important January in years, I honestly feel. And I think it's an even bigger one than usual, partly because we're top of the league, but also because now it's a World Cup break. I think you're going to see quite a bit of spending, because teams haven't played, so their agents, so their directors will be looking at targets and trying to scout players, and also looking at players in the World Cup that they could potentially bring in. Like you're already seeing Man United trying to go round and get Gakpo, and Chelsea look like they're getting Nkunku. So we have to be on alert of this, and absolutely now even more so than ever, now that Jesus is injured, and also that we are top of the league, we've got to take full advantage of this. And some of the players we have been linked with is Danilo, the Brazilian midfielder. I don't know anything about him, I'll be honest, but Edu seems to like him, and he seems to be a good option in the defensive midfield area. And if that's what he honestly thinks, then go and get him. Even if I haven't seen him play, then doesn't mean that they're not going to be good. So if you trust him, go and get him. And also there's Yuri Tillemans, who we were linked with all summer, but yeah, in for him. And he's made it clear that he is going to leave Leicester. And at least he's not going to go for any more than 50 million. And I think we better get him now, because there's other teams like Barcelona and Newcastle trying to go for him. And I think he'll be absolutely brilliant for our midfield, even though he may not start most weeks, but still he's an option, and he's someone that will also fight for his place. And he has actually been doing well at Leicester, and he is also a player that will link midfield to attack. I still don't think we've quite got that player that can actually quite link with midfield to attack. I know Xhaka has been doing the box-to-box really well, and no disrespect to him. And Odegaard in that number 10 has been our creative spark and obviously been guiding the team more forward. But I still think we could probably do with that player that can link from midfield to attack. And I think Tillemans can do that. And also he can get more goals from midfield, because we need more goals around the pitch. And if he's available for that cheap, then it's an absolute no-brainer, especially when he's made noises that he would be interested in a move to Arsenal. Then go and get him. You want players that want to play for you. Another player that we've been linked with is Mudryk from Shakhtar Donetsk. From what I've seen of him so far, he looks very good. And yes, we don't watch that league, and he could only be just be doing it in that league. But it is a big risk. But still, if it's a risk worth taking, then go and do it. I'm sure he'll definitely improve the attack that is already very good, and he will definitely get more goals. So again, I think that's a no-brainer, even if it means that we do have to overpay. If you overpay, you do generally get a good player. So there's three names I've thrown at you. There's a few other names I'm gonna throw at, especially more in the going forward positions. There's apparently, if João Felix is available on loan or available in January, because apparently he's not happy.
100% take him off.
He's available, especially on a loan. It's a no-brainer, because if you can't also get that big thing now, because they're not always easy to get in January, why not go for a loan? Like you saw Man United do it with Cavani, and at the time they all thought, panic boy, but it actually worked out really well for them. So maybe,
mate, Joao Felix is a quality player, bro. He's class. And maybe on his set, he can be really good.
Yeah, maybe get that player that can get you over the line. I can do enough, even if it is only for 6 months. Why not? And also, Juventus, look at their situation. They're apparently in big financial trouble, so they're gonna have to offload some players. If Vlahovic is available, and again, it's a no-brainer. If they're available, go and take them, because all these other clubs, they won't hesitate. They'll go for him. So there's two strikers I have thrown at you that will possibly be available this January. And yeah, come on,
Brandon, my man.
Yeah. And there's also a few more wingers we've been linked with, like Jeremy Pino, who we were also linked with in the summer for the Real.
He's a good player. Yeah,
he could be available. And I know Cody Gakpo, he's still available. He's a tall goal scoring player, and he's a quick player. And I'm seeing Man United are going all in for him, and I really would like him at Arsenal. I'm sure most of other people. And now seeing him in the World Cup, he's delivering.
I mean, we were linked with him, wasn't we? Last January, if I'm not wrong, we were linked with him. I swear.
We went with him in the summer, I definitely know that.
In the summer.
Yeah. So were teams like Southampton and Leeds. They were all in for him. In fact, he was really wanted by those two clubs. So, and now he's continuing to perform on global stage. And yes, when PSV played Arsenal at the Emirates, he didn't perform, but neither did any of their team. But when you play them in a return leg, he really did stand up. So that is surely a note to taking a punt on seriously. And if you want any Premier League proven players, why not test Brentford for Ivan Toney?
Yeah, exactly, man. Why not test what's the player?
Yeah, and why not test Brighton for Leonardo Trossard? Because I believe he's only got 6 months remaining on his contract. Why not test these clubs? And why not test Villa for Ollie Watkins? He's a player I've always liked.
Yeah, I've known him for years.
If you put the money down, they'll take it, because they'll take it. And these players now will want to come, because I now think we've put ourselves in a position where players want to play for Arsenal. I know last year Vlahovic turned us down, and that summer before Locatelli turned us down. But I don't think it's going to be the case this time, because they'll see now the project. Now they'll see that we're moving forward. We could be in a title race. We can offer potential Champions League football next season. What can these other clubs offer? What can Brighton offer? What can Brentford offer? What can Villa offer? They can't. So test these clubs, put the money down, and then you never know. But the thing is, there has to be a proper plan this January. There has to be. We can't just have one plan and then just spend all January and spend all the window relying on that plan and hope it pays off, because we saw it last year with Vlahovic. We wasted all January on him, and he made it clear he didn't want to come. So where was the plan B? I know Arsenal didn't want to overspend and didn't want to panic buy, but you need to have options. You need to have options. You should have a list. Right, this is the player we want. Can't get him. This is a player we want. And get these deals in nice and early because we're going to need people. We've got Tottenham. We've got Man United in general. We've got the FA Cup third and potentially fourth round.
Yeah. Then we're in Europa League.
Well, not in January we won't, but later on in the season. And then when you go into February, we've got for this is going to come fast because that's the month we're going to play Man City. And it's between the games when we play Brentford and Villa. And then, yes, we have the Europa League. So the games are really going to be coming thick and fast. And this board seriously needs to have a plan. And this January will seriously tell us whether this board is really interested about winning or not. Because we've put ourselves in a good position here. We have to take it. And we've seen over the years when we've not taken it and the risks that we've done. And we've not, especially last season and in other seasons when we've transitioned until January. Go and do it. And please do not make those same mistakes. I've given you enough targets there that we've been linked with. I want to hear what you guys think.
Yeah, big upset. But I do agree with my friend. There's some very good players that I think we should definitely sign. So Brandon, going to you, my friend, now. Look, just basing it off what Seb said, I know you've already gave a few players that you'd like to see, but look, your thoughts about going into this January window for Arsenal?
I think Sebastian has really hit everything nailed to the point. Everything was right to the dagger. It's absolutely true, you know. So let me give a differing perspective right now. All the players you mentioned have been really good targets. You know, if we Arsenal fans can think of targets, right, that means I'm positively sure the scouts and Edu and whatnot will know that these are the same players that will be talked about, right? Like what you said, Juventus going through financial issues.
Yeah.
João Felix not happy. You know, all these are rumors that I'm sure will go to each team, not even Arsenal, any big club, and will also go into their circles of, you know, their transfer targets and whatnot. Okay, so I do have a different perspective here. All right, let's see from a different angle. Do you think that this is a question to you guys? Yeah, because Sebastian has really, I have nothing much more to add. It's absolutely whatever Sebastian said. Those are the targets that we need to target for, right? So like people like Vlahovic, people like Tulemans, yeah, people like João Felix. You know, these are, if we are a big club, this is the kind of ambition that we want to see as fans, right? And the moment we do it, this just shows the confidence in the players, the teams, our team, our club, our fans, and to show that the kind of ambition that we are going for. You know, we don't want no offense to Kim Kjellstrøm, no offense to these kind of players, but this is not the January transfer windows that we are going for, you know. This is not, it's Kjellstrøm. Yes, he did score the penalty for us in the semi-finals in the FA Cup. He did score the penalty for us, but these are the players that are more for like a mid-tier club, right? Okay, so let me go on to my differing perspective here. Do you think that all these years, right, like what Sebastian pointed out, right, how many years of disappointment of being an Arsenal fans, like in terms of how much we never been too decisive in January transfer windows or transfer windows in general, do you think that this is actually good for Edu? Because this is the new kind of a new management that we're going in, right? This, he has so much ammunition to you know, Sebastian, you can make a PowerPoint slide right now, you can send it into the Arsenal board. These are so many examples that we have screwed up over the years, right? Yeah. This is a clear example that you can show the owners, like, okay, if you really want ambition in the club, we really want to win, right? As what you said, Sebastian, this is the best time that the perfect opportunity to capitalize. It's time to spend money, man. This is the time to spend money. There's no other time. There's really no other time.
We really right have.
Now, yes, have, right now you have Arteta. Right. Yeah, sorry, Josh. This time we have Arteta, who's, you know, built in such a good mentality for the squad. If Arteta wants a player, I think Edu and the management have to back him up and go out and get him. I think it's just a fair assessment for Arteta, you know. The fact that he has given so much for this club. I really believe that Arteta's obsessed with Arsenal. Like, he seems like a guy that's obsessive, and rightly so. You know, I think if you want to be a perfectionist like Pep Guardiola, this kind of managers, you need to be obsessed with the game, right? And his passion for Arsenal is second to none. You can see in the touchline, he's going at, sometimes I also feel very worried he's going to get a red card, because you see the touchline, he's always like outside the touchline.
He's always outside of it, yeah.
Yeah, he's always outside, which is good and bad. Good to see as an Arsenal fan, like, you know, you've got a manager there who would die for your players.
Right? Don't listen to what people like Richard Keys they're very obsessed with them. Just, oh, I wouldn't listen.
Fair point. So, Yeah, I think a differing perspective here is, so how many times we have screwed up in the January transfer window, right? This is the perfect time. If we do not capitalize on this, I'm sorry to say this, lads. You know, top three is still very successful to me, but if we do not capitalize on this transfer January transfer window, it's very sad to say that we may regret that decision of not capitalizing on this January transfer window. Yeah.
Well, yeah, this is going to be my next question to you guys, right? Is saying hindsight that we don't sign anyone, right? If they just think, we're clear, we're going to win the league and all that stuff. Just say we don't sign anyone, right? What would be your thoughts about Edu and, you know, Fronky and all that? And do you really think if we don't sign anyone, Arsenal could really bottle it and maybe get top four, but not challenge the league title, which we are in a very good position. We're 5 points clear. Like, who says we cannot change? So, yes, guys, what do you think, like, if we don't sign... Brandon's already mentioned it a little bit, so Seb, like, your thoughts on if we don't sign anyone?
Oh, if we don't sign anyone, then seriously, heads have seriously got to roll. And then you can tell that they're clearly not interested in winning, and yeah, it will really tell you that something is badly wrong. I seriously think it will be criminal if we do not act. Absolutely criminal, because injuries happen. Injuries happen all the time, and they happen to any club. It's not just us. They happen to any club. And with the fixture congestion, if you're going to be in title rated, you need a big squad. You cannot win it with a thin squad, especially if you've got Europe as well. You can't. But yeah, if we don't, then we'll just have to hope that we do hold on to the top four. I still think we should do it, because I think we have a massive gap between the likes of Chelsea and even a big gap with Man United. So I still think we should do it, but it's just not worth thinking about. We have to do it. Otherwise, it's going to be a long second half of the season.
100%. So yeah, moving on. Then we've got talk about a little bit about the second half of the season after the World Cup finishes. Of course, we have a very, very tough fixture schedule, as Seb pointed out as well. So I've named it Arsenal title challenge because I do believe we are in a title challenge. Like, no one can deny that. Like, we're 5 points clear, and I said it. Like, who would have actually thought going into this Christmas that Arsenal would be 5 points clear ahead of Man City? I mean, if anyone told you that at the start of the season, you would have sent them to like a mental hospital, because at the end of the day, nobody thought that we would be in this position right now. And look, obviously we're playing some beautiful football. And look, as we mentioned at the start of this, one of the best starts to Arsenal's Premier League history. And yeah, so look, as I said, the fixtures for me, we've got West Ham on Boxing Day. Then it is Brighton away. Then it is Newcastle. Then it is Liverpool. Anfield in it.
No, it's Oxford in the cup. And then it's Tottenham.
Tottenham away. Now, guys, you know we really struggled at Tottenham away. The last time we beat them was 2014. If I remember wrong, that was Rosicky's goal. Won it 1-0.
Right. Yeah.
We got to play Newcastle twice. Now Newcastle, they're third in the Premier. Mate, Newcastle.
It's a good Newcastle side. It's going to be a hard game.
January as well.
Definitely, with the money they'll add.
And then obviously we got Man City again twice. We got Man United, Chelsea, and even some of the like smaller clubs that we sometimes struggle against, like a Brighton away, for example. We really do. Leeds. Leeds and Everton away. Yeah. I think it was in Park Avenue, shocking there. Yeah. So
we'll go to Liverpool, go to Anfield as well. We got to go to West Ham. We got to go to Newcastle as well.
So look, the big question is like, how confident, guys? And of course, this all depended on in the window as well in January, right? But how confident, right, are you guys that Arsenal can finish, or at least be in a title challenge, finish second, say, this season, and go again next season? So I will start with Brandon, my friend. How confident are you for the second half of the season, my friend?
Oh, you know, I'm usually a very pessimistic Arsenal fan, but I'm super confident, mate. I know, as I say, top four is still a successful season for us. You know, we are overachieving. Yeah, we are overachieving right now. Yeah, you know, to the to the delight of all of us, we are overachieving, right? So that's good. We love to see it. But like what Sebastian is saying, you know, and Josh, three of us, you know, I'm sure most of the fan base, we are resonating right now with the same vibes. And what's the vibes? The vibes is we are overachieving and we need to have the squad right now. And that's why January transfer window is going to be a huge testament to our title challenge. Sebastian and yourself, before this point, you guys have rightly pointed out the schedule, right? The schedule is looking really tough for us. You know, all the more so tough, you know, it has, to me, I have all the stars are aligned, you know. And what do I mean by that? What I mean is, like, Edu has so much ammunition to go up to the board and say, like, okay, tough run of schedule. Gabriel Jesus is out. We have the best start in the Premier League history ever, even better than the Invincibles, right? Yeah. If we do not sign anyone with all these points, I think we are screwed, lads. We are screwed. We are not a top club anymore, you know. Unfortunately, as much as I hate to see it, right? Yeah. We are not thinking like a top club, you know. This is all, everything is going to our favor, you know, to get reinforcements. You know, even if we don't get the, you know, again, as a pessimistic Arsenal fan, even if we do not get like the top players, you know, of the transfer window, because, you know, we are going to overpay, like what Sebastian said, right? Sometimes overpaying is good because you get the quality, but looking at our history, we don't like to overpay stuff, right? I mean, maybe it's because of Wenger. I've been influenced by the Wenger years, right? Maybe now it's different, don't get me wrong, but as long as, to me, an ideal signing, because I didn't really address that, right? I would say Tulemans is a good signing. Even if we have to overpay him, I think he's a fantastic cover for Partey. You know,
he won't cost any more between 15 and 20 million. They'll have to get a bit of cash because he's out of contract.
Out of contract player, 15, 20 is still a lot. But if you put it into perspective, a 15, 20 million transfer that could potentially be the deciding factor in terms of our debt is a no-brainer, right? Sebastian, it is a no-brainer. We have to go for it, yeah? And then striker, I've been on the full cook drum. I've been on the hype train of full cook. I think he's a beauty. He's a great player. Mm. Striker-wise, you know, even though I say Kevin Volland is another player to look out for, I don't see many options right now, but Vlahovic, you know, even though he didn't want to come to Arsenal, Juve is going through some financial issues. Maybe we could come in with a competitive bit, you know, that maybe Juventus is like, okay, no, let's consider this bit. So yeah, to this segment, I think that I'm very optimistic about our title chances, but it all boils down to the board, you know, to Edu, whether they can get the business done in January transfer window. Even if we get another scenario. Let's assume that we go out, we get the players we want, and we do not win the title. I think as an Arsenal fan, at least I'll be of course very gutted, right? I'll be very sad, but at least I can safely say that my club is doing its ultimate best to go against the juggernaut that is City and Liverpool, for that matter. You know, we are trying. That's all we want to see from the board, the ambition that they are trying. We don't see any ambition. We don't see the signings. That's exactly why Arsenal fans are always in the mud. You know, we are always saying like, what if, what if, what if? And it's a bit irritating. It's, you know, and it's burning out as an Arsenal fan. You know, it's very tiring to see that.
Boring to say that, but that is what's been reality over the years. What if? Don't be saying that again anymore.
Well, yeah, Brandon, that's a good point because going back to what you said, about, you know, us overachieving this season, right? Because I'm sure many Arsenal fans, my target for me this season was, let's get back, because we bought it last season, let's get top four, let's get back Champions League. Was it the same for you guys? Top four is a
absolutely
for Arsenal this season.
I said it's a must.
It's a must. Yeah, it's definite this season, right? So even if we don't win the league, if we finish top four, I'd happily take that any day. Yeah, but if we finish fifth, then that's where I've got a big issue.
The thing is, how I look at it is that I can see what you're saying, but you don't understand. Things change as the season goes along. And if you look at what's happening to some of these other clubs, Chelsea are in transition. Man United are still in transition. They're getting better, but they're not there yet. Liverpool, they're going through a big transitional phase. You've got to think about what these other teams are doing and what they're likely to do. And they're likely to come back next year. So,
yeah,
I honestly think when you've got a golden opportunity, you have to be doing everything you can to try and take it. Even though if it wasn't what you thought at the start of the season, if it wasn't your target, you have to adapt as the season goes along. That's how I look at it. And I know last season you got a lot of fans when we didn't make top four by saying, oh, if he finished fifth, I would have taken that. I didn't like that because if you consider the situation, we had it all in our own hands. Yes. And it was Tottenham finishing above us out of all teams. And they weren't better than us that season.
They were very poor, very poor teams.
Exactly. So
don't mind me. It's the three game span, right? The Palace, which one was it? Brighton. It was that really. I was in London that when it happened. You know, I could have watched. I was thinking to go to Selhurst Park to watch Palace. Lucky I didn't go there.
I did actually go to that. Oh, dear me. It's terrible.
Yeah, thank God I was in London.
Even when we lost them three games, we still had a chance. We beat Chelsea and United. Mm. And it got to that Spurs game. We lost that. But we still had a chance. We would have been Newcastle. Then we lost that game as well. That was just a disgrace. And we were like 8 points. I'm pretty sure except we was 8 points clear at one point of top four.
Yeah, we were
8 points clear with Spurs once. I don't think.
Yes.
Yeah. It might have been top four. I swear we was. I remember it.
I know we were in a good lead, and we were definitely like I think 5 points clear going into the last three games. I remember that.
Something like that.
We were definitely 8 points clear of Spurs at one point, and then.
But then look what happened, you know.
But this is why I'm saying, you just got to take these chances when they count. The chances are.
Look, this is fact, Seb, because we are in a title challenge right now.
Yes.
Look, we're 5 points clear at Man City. Like, we have another half a season to go, of course, and anything can change. But you've got to look at it right now and say, we can win this league.
Definitely.
100%. But look, it's all going to depend what happens for me. In my opinion, I think January is, of course, probably one of the biggest windows in Arsenal's recent history for me, right? You getting the players, you getting that squad depth that we desperately need, right? Edwin, Kroenke and all that. Honestly, I can definitely see us being up there and winning this league title this season. Because the way we started has been amazing, as we pointed out. And with them additional signings, with that better squad depth as well, 100%, bro. 100% we can go and win this league. You know,
Could I just say something before we move on to this? Yeah. Sorry about it. So I just wanted to say, I agree, y'all. I disagree with like the fans that say, oh yeah, you know, we'll take fifth after finishing eighth. I think that's not the right mindset. Like what you guys say, we had fourth place and then we bottled it. That's unacceptable. Yeah.
Yes.
But I think to be fair, again, this is I play a bit of devil's advocate here. I think all this that happened last year really gave Arteta the kind of fire in him to be like, okay, we have a squad that's ready to challenge, right? We screwed it up last year, right? I think Arteta took ownership. It's like, it's my fault, right? I think that's why this club, our club, Arsenal, this season, right, has shown that Arteta has come out saying like, okay, believe in the boys. I say, look, we screwed it up last year. Our fans deserve better. We deserve to go back to Champions League. We screwed it up. Let's go out there. Let's play beautiful football, you know. Don't mind me, like F it, just go, right? And that's why this season started so strong for us, because it's usually Arsenal, we especially during the later years of Wenger, right? We were very conservative, you know. Yes, we played the Arsenal way, you know, we like to score beautiful goals, you know, we tend to play the right way, right? I love to see that kind of football, but we don't adapt as much compared to now. I think right now Arteta is really adapting to the style of play that, you know, if we are going up against a Brentford, right, we need to go hard against them. We're going against a Chelsea. We need to be a bit more conservative, right? We need to make sure that we are playing good, resounding football at the back. So I think that last year's experiences has really grown this squad. Yeah. So I think, you know, we are reaping the rewards of last year's disaster to this year's success. That's my opinion.
Yep. 100% agree with you, Brandon. Brandon, I just realized the time, bro. I think you got a stream, Brazil and Korea.
So I never, no worries. I'll go on like in like 2:58, like 58. No worries.
You sure, man? Because
I'm sure. I got it already, mate. Just now, Sebastian, you were talking. I was like doing the edits and whatnot. It's all good, really. So no, yeah, all good, mate.
There was one thing I just wanted to add.
Of course, man.
The thing is, I've been very pumped through the season after we beat Tottenham and Liverpool. That was when I really started to believe that we can win this league, and I have been saying all this long. I think we can definitely, but. Until I heard the Hazes rumour that he could be out for 3 months, I hate to be sound pessimistic, but I seriously can really see that being a big blow.
Big blow.
If he's out for 3 months. And I know we spoke about transfers, but whenever you get things like that, especially if it's one of your key players that's really elevated you, then it really does have an effect. And I really do worry about that, because obviously I've used some of the experiences in the past when we have been challenging, like Edrardo, Ramsey, Cazorla, and I really do fear that this potentially could...
What a player Eduardo would have been, right?
We just have to hope he's okay, and that we, and obviously we do get the right players in. But what I don't want is for them to recall Balogun on loan and then not sign a striker, because that ain't gonna work.
That's a good enough, man.
Because what you should do, let Balogun keep delivering out there in France and then come back and do it, because he might not be ready, because the French league is different to the Premier League. It's totally different league. So that's what I don't want to happen. Recall Balogun, then they'll think, oh well, that's done. It's not.
I got a question for you guys, right? Would you guys, because we ain't got no winner, right? Well, we got winner, but we ain't got back off a cycle. Would you guys recall Pepe back from Nice in January?
Yes.
Same with me. Would you? What about you, Brandon? Would you recall Nicolas Pepe back from Nice?
Yeah, I'm giving a bit of thought with it. Well, with his form right now, definitely there could be, like you guys, that's why it's quite resounding that, you know, we should bring him back. But he's had an issue with, I think Arteta has his issue with him, you know, like not really playing the kind of football. That could be a bit troubling to me. Of course, if you look at our form and the kind of depth that we need, of course, bring him back instantly, call him back right now, right? But I don't know. It could be a bit... Arteta has his reservations. I know he hasn't really publicly denounced Pepe, but Pepe is not an Arteta signing, and that's why he's not been playing much under Arteta. So that could be a sign for concern for Pepe's future in Arsenal.
And to be fair, I do like the player, and I do actually think there's something in there, but more I think about it, I don't actually think he really suits the Premier League. So I think it's actually probably best that we do actually... In the summer, I think it's probably best that we do probably look to move him on. But I think loaning him out was probably the right decision. But loaning him out without replacement was what I didn't like. So,
I mean, how's he doing?
What we don't want again is really... to bring him back and then we don't spend. That's what we don't do.
No, I agree with you, Teb. I mean, guys, you know how well... I don't watch the French league, but do you know how well he's doing at Nice? Is he doing all right?
Yeah, he is.
12 games, 4 goals. That's his current stats now for Nice.
Yeah.
Fair enough, man. Fair play to him, man.
He's best suited in that league, but
He used to smash it for Leo. He used to top scorer.
He is a goal threat. So why not?
But no, yeah. Before we do go, what final topic? Of course, the World Cup's on now. So look, Arsenal players shining at the World Cup at the moment. You know, we've got so many players in the World Cup right now playing for their countries. And look, Brandon, I said this, you asked me this when I came and watched on a few days ago, right? The Netherlands game. And look, guys, is it better for you, right, that we're getting the players back, you know, that parties came back, you know?
Ben White is back.
Tomiyasu's back. Or is it like you'd be happy for, you know, the players to go far in this competition? Sign off for you, Seb.
I'm not gonna lie. I prefer them to be back, to be honest, because we need these players. And yes, of course, we like England and we want Saka to perform on global stage. And to be fair, I do like him. Do want him to be playing, and I do. I'm happy.
He's been doing really well, mate.
The thing is, if he gets dropped to someone like Rashford or Foden. Mm. Then I honestly will not complain, because I even said after the game last night, once he scored the goals, right, take him off now. Because I even was saying, right, take him off now so he doesn't hurt himself even more. And it was good that Partey came back injury free. He's actually gone on the Dubai trip. He's gone straight.
Yeah, Dubai, yeah.
Yeah, I think some of the players that do return early this week will still Arteta will still want them to
oh, yeah, go. Because we're playing through friendlies, aren't we, in Dubai?
Yeah, we've got Lyon.
Juventus is at the Emirates, isn't it?
Yeah,
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, Juventus is at the Emirates, yeah.
And then I think in Dubai, I think we're playing Lyon and AC Milan, I think, as well.
Yeah.
So, yeah, look, it'd be good. I mean, I know we actually lost 4-2 to Watford, and I don't know if you saw that, both of you.
Right? I wouldn't worry about that. That was he completely changed the team at half time, and it was just full of kids. So don't read anything into that. But I think these games is where you can slightly have an idea. But yeah.
But yeah, Brandon, just quickly coming to you, my friend. Your thoughts on this, you know.
Again, you guys have made fantastic points. I think for me, it's like for Saka, of course, I'm Asian, right? Because you guys are, of course, rooting for England to bring it home, yeah? So obviously, there's a bit of bias from you guys. I mean, obviously, because you want your country to bring it home. Actually, I do feel like Bukayo Saka, right? This is only to Saka. I think that he's a kind of player that needs to be on the pitch to continue his run of form. I feel like if he's not on the pitch, right, that's when he dips a bit of confidence and whatnot. So, you know, hopefully, what I'm trying to say here is we just pray that he doesn't get any major injury in the next few games. Hoping, you know, I'm sure you guys are hoping for a deep run in the World Cup, but you guys are against France. Another topic for another day, but I don't know, you guys, can you guys get past the French resistance? I don't know, you know.
Mate, Mbappe against Walcott, mate, it's going to be hell.
It could have been Ben White, though. You know, Ben White, I would probably pocket him. Yeah. Ben White will pocket him. But yeah, I think to your point, right, I think definitely we need them to come back. You know, good that Partey is injury free. He's back, like what Sebastian said. He's joining the lads in the Dubai trip as well. That's good. Tomiyasu is also out today, as of today. So who are we left in the World Cup? We have Martinelli, Saka.
Xhaka. Bieber for France, even though he's not playing much. And Ramsdale, even though he's not playing much.
Yeah, but, so that means basically is Saka. To be honest, it's only Saka and Xhaka. Xhaka and the two Saka and Xhaka, those two. You know, it's Martinelli off the bench. It's good because I think it keeps him fresh, you know, against top-tier opponents.
Good point. Yeah.
20, 30 minutes run-ins, you know, it's good for him. Yeah. He doesn't have to play the whole game. I think it's fantastic for him. And yeah, I think we are looking good. We are looking good in terms of like, Gabriel Jesus. If we really needed to get an injury, unfortunately, I'm so sorry to say this, but I think Gabriel Jesus must have been the player, you know, if we had to get an injury to a certain first-team player. Unfortunately, you know, if it's Xhaka, if it's Partey, if it's even Saka as well, I think those three would have been we will feel the presence even more than Gabriel Jesus right now.
Yes. Seb, you want to say anything before we wrap up?
I think everything's been covered.
Yeah, it's been fantastic, lads. You know, it's been an absolute pleasure. Just quickly, I want to thank both of you. Starting for you, Brandon, my friend. Shout out your channel, of course, and all that, where people can find you.
All right, so our handle is The Goal Difference. I'm from Singapore. I'm an Arsenal fan. We do vlogs, we do live watch-alongs, we do anything football content related, live shows. Do check us out. We are growing as well. So thank you so much, Josh, for having me on. Thank you, Sebastian. As always, you're such a great contributor to Josh's channel. You know, I always watch you guys and you guys are fantastic. So, you know, just give it a try. Maybe you like our content. I'm from Singapore as well. So Asian pride. Thanks, guys.
Come on. Brandon, thanks so much for coming on and taking your time out today, of course, on my channel. Seb, of course, you are the co-host of this, as always. And yeah, obviously, people can find you on Instagram and Twitter. And, you know, you write the articles, which you wrote. Thanks for the one today, my friend. It really helped, you know, introduce the stream. You know? But anyway, it's been a pleasure, guys. Thanks so much. And yeah, look, we're going to do a podcast and say about after maybe Brighton into Newcastle, and hopefully we've got 6 points again, and we're flying once again after this. Fingers crossed.
Pray for Jesus, please.
Pray for Jesus. Yeah.
Maybe a faster recovery, right? A faster recovery. Maybe 2 months. Hope. Yeah, yeah.
I really, really hope this is not a long-term injury.
That's where I see that. But yeah, look, it's been a pleasure. Big up to everyone who's watching. Well, I've pre-recorded it today, so comment your thoughts down below, and yeah, subscribe to Brandon as well, and we'll see you guys in another video very soon. Come on, you Gunners.
Come on, you Gunners.